All right, come on in, get a seat if you will. We are going to go ahead and get started this morning, so come on in and get a seat. Hey, before we do anything else, everybody listening? Before we do anything else, don't the Christmas decorations look good? Yes. Thank you. It puts you in the mood, doesn't it?
Yes.
Just kind of puts you in the mood, especially after all that turkey dressing, corn, all that other stuff, sweet potatoes, all that stuff, yeah, which I love. Okay, and I know many of you do too. All right, well, let's get the announcements out of the way. Next Sunday is a very special Sunday in the life of our church, in the life of two of our people, Nathan Ash. We're going to be ordaining him as one of our deacons next Sunday. He and Teresa are out this week, but this is part of her life too, okay? And I don't know if you've ever been part of an ordination service or not, but if not, you will be next week, okay? And it's a time for us just to ordain and approve and just kind of support one of the men in our church that's kind of moving into that role. And we're very, very proud of Nathan and Teresa and the work they do and the certain way they serve the church. So be here with us next Sunday, okay? That's going to be our service next Sunday, the ordination service. So if you've never been to one, please join us because that's going to be just a really good time, all right? And then on the 14th of this month, on Wednesday night, coming up just in a couple, a week or so, is our ministry meeting. And most of you know by now, some people used to call them business meetings, but that's the time where we're just going to kind of give everybody an update, an overview of things before we end the year, and then some special announcement as well that night. So please just be here, okay? We're only here about 50 minutes or so, unless we get a lot of questions or get into a lot of conversation. But just show some interest in that, okay? And be here on that Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, and we'll give you an update, okay? The Christmas schedule. I just want to remind you, in case you were asking questions about that, we've put our Christmas schedule in the email. So if you don't get the email, let us know. We'll make sure you get one. Or you can pick one up at the Welcome Center on your way out this morning. And that kind of lets you know what we'll be doing over the holiday season, all the way through and up to the first of the year, okay? Last thing I want to mention this morning is our Lottie Moon Christmas offering for foreign missions, okay? You've probably seen all the postcards and Christmas cards out in the hallway. Well, what that's for is to save you money. That's what it's for. If you want to mail someone a Christmas card, you don't have to this year or any other year. You can write your Christmas card out, put someone's name on it, give it to our ladies out there at the table, pay 20 cents per card, okay? That's pretty cheap, don't you think? Don't you think that's a great deal? Mm-hmm. That's less than half the price, okay? And they'll make sure that as long as the person you're giving the card to is like on a list or in the church, they'll get those people their cards, okay, before the end of the year. So do that, all right? If you want to give somebody a card, do it through that. All the money that goes, that's collected for the Christmas cards goes to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, okay? And we're taking up those monies right now. And that, again, that's for foreign missions. Our goal is $800. Last year, our goal was $600, or $500 or $600. And we collected about $1,600. Yeah, I'm just waiting for you, okay? I think it's super. You know, if you ever think about doing some work outside of your own country, this is the easiest, best, and cheapest way for you to do it. I've been on mission trips. Even back when I took them, they cost $3,000 to $4,000 to go on a mission trip. Who knows what they cost now? But you can donate money to the foreign mission offering, Lottie Moon, and that money goes to help support missionaries in 189 different countries. Yeah, so that's a bargain, all right? But who cares about a bargain? It's an interesting way to invest in the kingdom of Almighty God. So let's do that, okay, together. Let's stand and pray this morning. Father, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to be in your house today. We could be anywhere. We could be doing anything, Lord. This is a free country. But people have gathered here to worship. There are some watching on Facebook this morning. And we just pray, before we even begin, that as we go into worship, that our hearts will go vertical from where we're at right now in our seats, our minds, our hearts, that we'll just go vertical today, Lord, and we'll meet you face to face in a spiritual way at the throne of God. And then, Father, we pray for the word. Lord, it's not me speaking. It's your word is where the power is. So use that today, God, in the lives and hearts of people. We're going to be doing a special message today on caregiving, on giving care to people. And I pray that you would speak to people's hearts. You would encourage those who are in the middle of giving care to someone. Lord, that maybe there are people here that are not involved in that, and maybe someday they will be. So just bless them as well, Lord. And the Holy Spirit, you can say whatever you want to today, no matter what words are preached. And so meet everyone's need at the point in which they are today. That Jesus, you may receive the glory, that our hearts will be turned in your direction, and that we may praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, God bless you.
Little town of Bethlehem.
appreciate that so much. So much. I read some stories this week about people who are doing caregiving. And one of the stories went kind of like this. The guy said he was working with an adult daycare center for dementia patients. And he said, I was working with a female patient who was in her 90s. And he said this woman was barely coherent. And at one point he said, you know, I was just looking at her, just observing her. I mean, it wasn't like checking her out, but he was looking at her, just kind of observing her, and all of a sudden, I don't know if she sensed this or what, but she looked up at him, and she smiled real big, and she said, "You like what you see, sailor?" Funny things happen, don't they, when you're caring for people. There was a guy who was caring for his wife. He said she was in the early stages of Alzheimer's. And he said, I told her one morning, he said, I got up and I was looking for the remote control. By the way, no guy ever knows where the remote control is. And he said, I was looking for the remote control. And I told my wife, I can't remember where I put the remote control. And she looked at him with the most serious look in her eye. And she said, honey, do you need one of my pills? So, if you're caring for someone, or you have cared for someone, you know they can say some pretty funny things sometimes, not really being intentional about it. But caregiving is not a laughing matter, is it? I want to begin this morning in the book of Hebrews, chapter 6, verse 10. And you know, I put it in our email this week that I was going to be doing a message on caregiving. So many of the people in our church and people you may know are giving care to someone.
Amen.
Yeah, they're watching over people. They're doing the best they can to give care to somebody inside the home or maybe at a nursing home, hospital or something. I want to begin with this one verse in Hebrews chapter 6. And it says, for God is not unjust. He will not forget how hard you've worked for him and how you've shown your love to him by caring for other believers as you still do. So if nothing else this morning, I want you to take that verse as an encouragement if you're a caregiver, that God will never forget what you're doing. And how you, as you serve that person that you're caring for, you are also serving him. And that he will never forget that as you show your love through Christ to that person. Now, folks, as we look at caregiving, caregiving is a pretty broad subject. You know, doctors, therapists, pharmacists, you know, all the people like that who are connected to the health and medical field are in some way caregivers. But then there's the inexperienced. There's the people who are not trained to give care, that are still giving care maybe on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. And I also want to include those who may be caring or raising children right now. I can't tell you how many people that I know that are raising or helping to raise grandchildren. And some, believe it or not, even great-grandchildren. So it's almost like everybody that we're connected to today is caring for someone on some level, in some capacity. And then I want to kind of remind us all of this today too, because we can get caught up in the physical and the emotional and even the spiritual roller coaster of wondering, what am I supposed to do? Okay? I mean, if you're caring for someone, or you have done that, at some point you've probably asked yourself this: what am I supposed to do? Because you feel limitations. I mean, you feel maybe, you know, like you don't know what to do sometimes, and you wonder what the answers are. Well, I don't want to attempt this morning for our worship service to turn into a counseling session. I would probably fail miserably at that. But I do want to turn our attention to some scriptures that I believe teach us about caregivers. Now, folks, this message today is a lot like other topical messages. There's no particular chapter in the Bible that talks about caregivers. You know, we can't go to Psalm 1 of the, that's the, that. But there are verses that teach us and give us insight on how we can be caregivers. I'm going to attempt to give some of those to you this morning. It's not conclusive like so many other messages, but I want to attempt to encourage you and give you some guidelines, some instruction from the scriptures on how we might do that, okay? So, the Bible doesn't have specific chapters on this, but it does mention people, and there's a particular story that I think we can get a lot of insight out of, and that's the story of Ruth and Naomi. Now, you might want to turn there. You probably are familiar with the story. We're not going to unpack that story today. But I think more than any other story in the Bible, that story and the relationship that Ruth has with her mother-in-law, Naomi, give us a really good insight and maybe even a great pattern for giving care to others. Although, Naomi wasn't really sick, okay? But there's some patterns there that I think are helpful to us. Before we get there, you know, Jesus taught something very important, I believe, in the principles of giving care. So we're going to look at that as well in Matthew chapter 10, verse 42. We're going to put it on the screen for you so you can see it. And I put it up there in the Amplified Version of the Bible because I think that helps a little bit. So let's look at this together. And whoever gives to one of the little ones, and what that means is these who are humble in rank and influence, the little ones, the least of these, whoever gives them even a cup of cold water to drink, because he is my disciple, truly I say to you, he will not lose his reward. Now I want you to take a lot of comfort from that today. I want you to be encouraged knowing that every moment that you spend giving care to someone, every time you give up some of your time to help someone else, that you are doing it in the name of the Lord. You're doing it to honor and glorify Him. And I want you to be encouraged by that. You know, I think this shows up pretty clear when we look at these things, these two scriptures this morning. I think it shows up pretty clear in the story of Ruth and Naomi. Now, obviously, these two women were not married, nor could they be, okay? But they did have a very different and very strong relationship together of caring. You see, you have to understand, when you go back to that story, that both of these women were widows. And then when you go back to the biblical understanding of that, it helps you get a better glimpse of what's going on here. Because when you go back to the Old Testament and you look at this word, widow, that word simply describes a woman who could not speak for herself. When you see widow in the Old Testament, it was a woman who had to have someone take care of her. You see, all of her life, she had depended on her husband to do that. And now that her husband, both of their husbands were gone, they needed someone to depend on for whatever their husband had provided for them. And now they're depending on each other. You see, a widow had to be dependent on somebody, and Ruth shows up to show us how to do that. Now, there are three things here that we're going to look at this morning, okay? Very simple things. We're going to go through them rather quickly, and I want you to follow along with me as we do, okay? Number one is this. From the story today, we see this, that Ruth was determined to take care of Naomi. She had a determined commitment to take care of her mother-in-law, okay? Now, when you look at that story, there are two things that kind of stand out, I think, in my mind. You see, Ruth had the opportunity to go back to her homeland, to grab a husband, to build life and home for herself and be free of all the obligations of taking care of her mother-in-law. She could have done that with all the freedom, no guilt, no shame, none of those things involved. Naomi, her mother-in-law, actually gave her permission to do that. But Ruth decided that her commitment to Naomi was deeper than her commitment to herself. And so Ruth stays with Naomi, now get this, in a place where she didn't have to be. Now let's be honest this morning, folks, because sometimes caregivers find themselves in a place where they don't have to be. They even find themselves sometimes in a place where they don't want to be. And it's not that they don't love the person they're caring for, but if they had a choice, in all honesty and reality, sometimes they'd rather be somewhere else. You see, caregivers give up a lot. And Ruth shows us that a caregiver's life is going to include some sacrifice on our part. Now listen this morning. If you're a caregiver or you've been giving care to someone, there may be times in your life when you feel like you've been forgotten. There may be times in your life when you feel like you are left behind. And there may be moments in your life when you feel like you're left out of your own life because you're caring for somebody else. But I want you to remind yourself this morning that God is right there with you every moment that you're giving care. You may not realize it this morning, but you are in the palm of God's hand. And we have that as a promise in the scripture, that you are in the palm of his hand. And you may not realize it this morning, but every moment that you spend with that person, you are demonstrating the selfless love of Jesus Christ in that person's life. And that should be a great encouragement to you as you give care to someone else. You see, this is the person that can't do certain things for themselves. They can't do certain things on their own. They need someone to help them just like you. And God has placed you in a very special role right now to care for that person, just like he did Ruth to care for her mother-in-law, Naomi.
Amen.
That's right. You are in a special role right now. You may not feel like it. You may feel inconvenienced, that you'd rather be anywhere else in the world. Not that you don't love that person, as I said a moment ago, but this is not what you would choose for you or them. But God has put you in that role for a very special reason in their lives and in yours. You see, every day and every time that you're needed is a time when God is using your life for that precious soul who needs you. Here's what Ruth said. Let me remind you. We're not going to turn there. Let me remind you what Ruth said. In chapter 1, verse 16, she said to Naomi, her mother-in-law, she said, "Don't plead with me to abandon you. Please don't make me return to my home and not follow you." She said, "Wherever you go, that's where I'm going to go. And wherever you build your life, that's where I'm going to build my life." She was absolutely determined and committed to stay with the person whom she was given to care for. The second thing is this, not only did she have determination, and you know what, guys? It takes a lot of determination. You don't have to respond or shake your head or anything like that, but it takes a lot of determination to care for someone else on a daily basis, a weekly basis, a monthly basis. Move them into your home. Adjust your whole life for someone else. That takes sheer determination. Second thing is a unique bond. You see, her bond to Ruth gave her the drive she needed to care for Ruth. A unique bond with her. Something interesting here is that there's a bond that can happen between two people, one, the caregiver and the one being cared for, and there are good reasons for that. Let me give them to you, okay? Number one is this, is because Naomi was never alone. You see, the person that you're caring for, because of you, because of your commitment to that person, that person is never alone. You are always there with them when you can be. And they never have to spend 1 minute of their time alone. The second thing is that God is providing someone to watch over them. You're it. Tag, you're it. And not one of us would choose that for ourselves. But God does give people a special role sometimes to be caregivers. And you are a unique person if you can do that and do it well. That's what Ruth was, a unique person. See, God shows us through the book and the life of this beautiful woman that he sees what she's doing and how much she's sacrificing for her mother-in-law, Naomi. How do we know that? It's because God pens her story in divine, holy words. That story's penned there. And that's how we know that God sees how important that is. And the same thing with your life. You see, there is a reward and rewards for caring for other people. The bond that Ruth had with Naomi, you know what it was built on, folks? It was built on love. Love. And your love for the person that you're caring for, you know what it does? It goes so deep for that person that it overrides the love you have for yourself. It moves you out of the walls of selfishness. For years I've watched people take care of others in nursing homes, hospitals, in their own homes. And many times I've wondered, how in the world do they do that? And some are wired more for it, are better for it than others. But there are also literally people doing that today because they just simply love the person that they're caring for, and that moves them out of every ounce of selfishness in their life. And that's a unique bond. So a third thing is this, is sheer determination. You know, God actually equips you for what you're doing. Have you ever felt that way? If you're caring for someone this morning, do you feel equipped for that? Do you? Sometimes you do. Sometimes God will just simply equip you for something that you didn't prepare for. There may be something in your life this morning that you find yourself doing, and you're wondering, how in the world am I doing that? I don't know how I'm getting through this. God is equipping you to do this. God equipped Ruth to take care of her mother-in-law, Naomi. And I do believe that some people are just simply wired for it. You know, when you look at that person or you think about the one that you're giving care to this morning, you know, you can't set health goals for that person. Boy, it would be nice if you could. If you could set the health goals for that person. But you know what we can do? You can determine that you're going to do your best with them. And you know what, guys? That is all God expects from you, is to do your best. That's all he expects from you, is simply doing your best. Saturday morning, my wife and I, we went over, we're doing everything we can to care for my mother right now, and along with my siblings. And Saturday morning, we went over there, and this is kind of strange, you know, some of you have gone through this, and hopefully many of you will not ever have to, but you go over and you have to get your own mother out of bed, and you have to pick her up, and Becky's standing there in front of her, and we're putting her in her wheelchair and getting her ready and wheeling her into the kitchen. And I told my sisters, I said, we're going to do something different today. I said, we're not going to put Mom in her chair, and she's going to have her breakfast here at the table. So we wheeled her up to the table, and she sleeps most of the time. She's not really cognizant that I know of, although they can hear everything that you say to them. And we wheeled her up there, and my sister brought the breakfast in, and my wife, Becky, she took the food and started feeding it to my mom. And, you know, she ate her eggs, and she ate her applesauce, and she didn't know it, but her medicine was ground up in her applesauce. And there's always one way to get it down there in there. And I'm not trying to draw attention to anybody this morning, but I watched my wife feed my mother with a spoon her breakfast that morning. I've never seen that before. And then came time for coffee. And one of the most precious sights that I ever saw was my wife holding that coffee cup up to my mother's lips and my putting that coffee cup up there and just barely sipping at that coffee. And that was a sight for me to see. and watching my wife give care to my almost 89-year-old mother, who, by the way, was the one who always gave care to everybody else. You know, I don't wish that for her. I wish something different for her. But I don't get to set goals. I don't get to set health goals for her. Just like you don't get to with the people you're caring for. It'd be nice if we could. But we don't get to do that. What we do get to do is we get to care for them. And we get to spend time with them. And we get to invest our lives in them to make sure that their life, as much as we can, and as much as they have left over, is the best quality that we can give them. Now let's flip the coin over for a minute, okay? You know, this doesn't mean that you don't take care of your own needs. I've watched this many times, how the caregiver becomes so worn down that now they need care. And if you're giving care this morning, let me give you a few words. I've seen other people's lives slowly deteriorate and come apart because they don't see the balance in giving care. So how can you care for yourself and still care? I want to show you a verse in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. And we're going to read that together. You've seen this before. Cast all your anxiety on him because he, Jesus, cares for you. Now that sounds pretty simple. That sounds pretty elementary. It's like there's nothing profound there whatsoever. Oh, but wait. There is something interesting there. If you're giving care to someone this morning, I want to share something with you that comes from this verse that I think can help you, okay? So you either jot it down, you memorize it, or you think and ponder about this, okay, if you're giving care to somebody. And I'll explain this in just a second. You see, right before Peter penned these words, if you go back just one verse, Peter talks about something very important. He talks about us being humble, first of all. And you know what that means? It means that we have to admit that we need help too. Okay? One thing that a caregiver has to admit is that sometimes they need help. They need help. I've told both of my sisters, I said, look, I can't make you do anything, but I can come over here and give you a break. And when I come over and give you a break, you can go somewhere else and do something else. You can do that. Now, if you choose not to, I can't help that, okay? I'm giving you a break, but you have to take the break. You see, if you're giving care to someone, there are moments, there may be hours in which you need a break. There may be times when you need help. And if someone offers help to you, don't feel like you're putting that person out. Receive the gift that's being offered. Because you need to balance your life too. No one can spend every waking moment doing that. You will absolutely destroy yourself. When Peter penned that word humble, it simply means that we're willing to take the lower place, the place of giving care and the place of caregiving. Now let's go to a word here in this sixth verse, the word cast. Peter says, cast all your anxiety on him because, now that's an important word there, because. See the progression in that? Cast all of your anxiety, your worries, your cares, your frustrations, your exhaustion, all of those things, cast all of those things on him. Why? Because he cares for you. There will be moments when you feel like nobody cares for you. There'll be times when you feel like, does anybody even know what's going on here but me? You know, like I said before, there will be moments when you feel forgotten. You'll feel like your own life sometimes has left you. That there's nothing left. This is all that's left as you care for someone else. Now let's go back to this for a moment, okay? Let's go back to the New Testament. We're not going to turn there. I want to turn your minds there. Most people are familiar with the Apostle Peter and his vocation. Peter vocationally was a fisherman, okay? So he's going to write from that. You know, from that experience, just like any of us, we talk from our experiences, don't we? Anytime someone else has an experience, we have a better one, don't we? Right? We have a bigger one. And so Peter's penning these words from his own experience as a fisherman. So Peter fully understands what the word cast means. Now think about it. When Peter was a fisherman, let's just pretend this morning that you are in the boat with Peter. If you're a caregiver this morning, you're in the boat with somebody. And let's just say you're in the boat with Peter, and you're out on XYZ Lake fishing for fish. There's one thing, two things actually, that Peter never, one thing he didn't use, and one thing he didn't do. Peter never used a rod and reel to fish with. There was no Shimano back then, okay? Peter used a net. And so he fully understood what a net meant, and he was trying to communicate that with us as his listeners. You see, the net that Peter's talking about this morning is the thing that you and I find ourselves in at moments when we're caring for someone else. The net represents this. It represents this tangled up mess. The net represents this soggy, wet thing that we throw out there from the boat and try to catch fish with. That's what the net represents. You see, sometimes when you're caring for someone else, you may feel like you're in this tangled up mess. You may feel like you're trying to grab a hold of this soggy, wet, heavy thing all by yourself and pick it up and throw it out of the boat into the water to catch the fish. You may feel like that. And that's what Peter's saying. This tangled up mess, this life full of anxiety, these problems that you're carrying this morning, this thing that seems so heavy. Now listen, we can move outside the realm of caregiving this morning and into your circle. And we can say this, the thing that you are carrying this morning seems so heavy that you can't even lift it off this, you can't even lift it off the bottom of the boat. And you're supposed to cast it. That's what God wants you to do. And if you need help doing it, God wants to be that help that you need to throw this thing away. So you're trying to throw this wet, soggy thing out by yourself. And that's where the Lord wants to help you. Furthermore, let me say this. There are times when you're carrying heavy burdens that you need to let them fall. Do you ever think about that? There are times when you're carrying a heavy burden and you just simply need to let it fall. Now, those of us who are type A personalities, it's hard to do that, isn't it? It's hard for problem solvers to do that. But there are times when you have to let it fall and throw it out because you can't do this by yourself. And the Lord wants to be right there with you in the boat, whatever boat you're sailing in, and He wants to help you pick up your net and throw it out there. You can't downplay the situation you're in, ladies and gentlemen. Now, let's be real today, because emotional stress is something that will absolutely destroy you. And there are moments that you need rest and recovery, and you need to throw your net into the sea. There are moments when exhaustion and frustration almost overwhelm you, and you have to keep telling yourself that exhaustion and frustration is natural. It's natural. Don't feel guilty because you're tired. Don't feel guilty because you're exhausted. Don't feel guilty because there may come a day when you just simply don't feel like doing this. It's natural. And that's when God wants you to come to Him and ask for the strength that only He can give you. Because when you feel frustrated and exhausted and worn out, listen. That has nothing to do with how much you love that person. It has nothing to do with it. That's natural, physical, and emotional feelings that you go through. And then if you have a sense of being alone, guess what? You're not. Now, everybody's relationship with the Lord is something that only He, her, and God knows. Only you know what your relationship is with God this morning. You're the only one on planet Earth that knows that. But listen, God wants to be your strength. He wants to be your comfort. God wants to be your peace this morning. And He wants to be all that you need at the moment that you need Him, if you will trust Him. Trust Him. What does that mean to trust God? We say, we hear that all. What does it mean to trust God? It simply means that you're going to come to God in the humblest, in a way that is the most absolute real that you can, and say, you know what, Lord, I can't do this on my own. I need a strength that's bigger than me. I need something that transcends my own abilities this morning. I need that. And I'm going to trust you with my heart, with my soul, with my mind, and all my being this morning. And I'm just simply going to offer myself to you because you care for me. And I need you in a very real way. If you've never prayed that prayer, pray it today. Try this, ladies and gentlemen. Please do this. Just go to God and say, Lord, I need you. And let God fill in the gaps. You see, it's plastered all over the Bible that God cares for you, that Jesus cares for you more than you'll ever know. He cares for you. He understands your limited time. He understands your limited abilities. Here's what he said. He said, come unto me, all of you who are weary and are burdened. Now, that's just about all of us at one point or another, isn't it? I'd say we all fit there somewhere in our life. Weary and burdened. Do you feel wearied this morning? Now, I'm not trying to be negative, okay? I'm not trying to be, you know, critical or anything like that, but there are just moments that we all just, man, I'm just weary, okay? It's not that I don't want to do this. I don't know that I can, at least not for the moment. And Jesus said, if you're weary this morning, he said, I want you to come to me. If you're carrying a burden this morning that's way too heavy for you, he said, I want you to come to me. You know what he said he would do if we did that? He said, I will give you rest. I can't explain this. You have to experience this. I've tried many ways to explain this. But I know this from experience. When you receive the rest and the peace that only God can give you, there's something supernatural, something spiritual that happens when the peace of God comes over you that you can't explain. And it's not a feeling. It's not an emotion. It's a spirit thing. And that's what he wants to do for you today. If you'll just let him, just reach out and let him. I'm coming to you this morning, Lord. And I'm bringing this weariness with me, this frustration. I'm bringing this exhaustion with me this morning. And I'm going to give to you all these burdens. You know why? Because I want your rest. I want rest. And then he said this, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. I did a funeral for a friend of mine last week, a missions pastor. And I made reference to this a little bit last Sunday. When you do funerals for people that, I mean, you know the person, the family, but you don't really know all those people that sit out there. You know, the 100, 150 people, you don't know who they are. A lot of young people sitting out there, you know, you don't know what's going on in people's lives, young, old, middle-aged, whatever, whoever they are. You don't know that. But I told, you know, when you're trying to ask people to come to the Lord, you have to be able to relate to that. And I told folks this. I said, you know what? I've been speaking in churches since I was 23 years old. And 10 years later, okay, just see if you're listening. No, 40-something years later. There's not one time that I get up and speak, whether it's a Bible study, a message, whatever it is, that I don't say, God, if you don't help me, I can't do this. Amen. Not one time. In all those years, all those churches, all those people, all those funerals, beyond our abilities. And sometimes I wonder, folks, are we really trusting in that power when we need to? That's what he wants. He wants to give you what you cannot give yourself. He offers you what you cannot do for yourself. And it's a supernatural power that's above and beyond anything on planet Earth. And all he asks is this, is for you and I to come. That's all he asks, to come in faith, to trust him, to fill the gaps, to offer the ability, to provide the strength that only he can give. And you know what? I think that is the place where we should pray. I want you to bow your head and close your eyes for a minute. You know, this week I was thinking about my own situation and your situation and what the scriptures tell us about giving care. There's no way that you can unpack all that in 30 or 40 minutes. So I just have to trust that the Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart. And I do trust that. Now I want to ask you this morning, while you're sitting there, I want you just to ponder for a minute your own situation, not the person next to you, the one behind you, or the one who's still at home, your situation. Would you say this morning, Pastor, there is a burden that I'm carrying. I'm trying to pick this net up and I just can't move it. There's something going on in my life right now that no one else knows about and I need help. I need God's help. Would you just raise your hand, put it right back down. I just want to pray for you. That's all. I'm not going to point you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. That's all it is, folks. It's just acknowledging to God. You know what, God? I just acknowledge that I need something from you that maybe only you and I know about. And then this morning, it's like, you know, God, Jesus, you said if I would come. And I need to come. And I need to take steps in coming. Not just good intentions. I need to make steps in your direction. This has gone on long enough. I've thought about it long enough. I've gotten through it long enough. And now I need to take steps in your direction. I just want to pray for you. I give you my word. I will not call you out in any way. But you might say, Pastor, I need to take steps in the Lord's direction this morning. Would you raise your hand today? Just thank you so much. Just need to take steps in his direction today. Yep. Mm-hmm. And then one more thing. You see, none of this really works outside of a relationship with God. And Jesus tells us that the only way we can have that is through him. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father unless they come by me. And in all honesty, if you were to just be absolutely honest with yourself this morning, and you would say, Pastor, I need a relationship with God. I need Christ in my life. Would you pray for me? Would you just lift your hand just very quickly? You can put it right back down. I need Christ in my life today. Thank you. Yep. I need him to help me. I need him to save me. To save me today. Would you raise your hand? Father, thank you. What an amazing thing it is, God, when we admit that we need you. When we come, Lord, the first step is just simply admitting it. Now I pray over everyone who's raised their hand this morning for those burdens, for the things that they're carrying, God, for the loads, for the wet nets, for the inability to do it on their own. I pray for them today, God, that you, as they reach out to you, that you would give them strength from your throne today, and that they would feel that, they would experience that through the presence of your Holy Spirit right now as we pray. Lord, I pray for those people who said that I need to take steps in Jesus' direction, that you would give them, Lord, just courage and strength. Just to literally take those steps in your direction, that you would meet them right there in that place where they need you. I pray for all the people here today, those on Facebook or anywhere else they may be, that are giving care to somebody, that you will, God, come and strengthen them, that you will give them rest today, that you will replace that exhaustion, that you will replace that frustration, that you'll give them, Lord, strength and power and peace, that you'll give them patience and understanding and deepen their love, Lord, for you first and then for that person that they're giving care to. I pray that today on their lives, Lord, in their hearts, in their minds, I pray that on them. And Father, for whatever else may be needed today, in advance, we give you the praise for it. And now, God, it's just time to respond. So as we sing this song, as we lift up your name with our voices, Lord, may people just simply respond to you. And we pray in Jesus' name. Now, folks, go ahead and stand up, if you will. We give an altar call. We give a commitment time here. And there's nothing, nobody's going to ever ask you to do anything that you're uncomfortable with. But we don't know how to help. We don't know what we don't know. And if you'd like to come this morning and you'd like to come to the altar, there really is something special about that. There's nothing magical here, but there's something about taking those steps and praying at the altar. If you'd like to do that this morning, you can come and you can pray, you can lift your burden up. You may want to come with somebody. You can do that. You can go back to your seat. We'll say a word to you. If you need help this morning, if you need prayer, I'll be more than happy to pray with you now after the service. If you're here this morning, this is the most serious thing you can do. And you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, He's calling your name today. He wants to save you today. And we want to help you with that, okay? So, Crystal, would you lead us in this song, please?
Bring me back to you.
listen, please make sure you welcome someone before you leave today. One of the things we hear most is that our folks are really, really, really friendly. Okay? So make sure you welcome someone on your way out today, okay? Let them know how much you appreciate them being here. And may you have a good day, good week, whatever you're doing. May God bless you. Okay?